Well, welcome to today's program. I'm joined today again by my dear brothers, fellow ministers, Pastor Henry Johnson of Trinity Presbyterian Church in Tazewell, Virginia, and Jim Thornton, who's the pastor of Reformed Faith Presbyterian Church in Clarksville, Tennessee. And I'm Patrick Hines, the pastor of Bridwell Heights Presbyterian Church in Kingsport, Tennessee. So, gents, it's good to see you guys again. And we had a little timing issue with Henry last time, but that's okay. Glad he's here with us. So we're gonna let him go first this time, and we're gonna pick right up where we left off. We were originally planning to do Romans 9, but we backed up a little bit because we wanted to get more context and start at verse 28. And Jim and I got through 28, 29, and 30, and got through the golden chain there. So that just kind of sets up the context. You have the great golden chain there, those whom he foreknew, he predestined to be conformed to the image of his son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom he predestined, these he also called. Whom he called, these he also justified. And whom he justified, these he also glorified. And that brings us to where we're going to pick up today, verse 31. And I'll read the first couple verses, and then Henry, you can exposit them for us. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? So I hand it over to you, Brother Henry.
What an amazing God the God of the Bible is. And verse 31 highlights the grace of God that we had the joy of hearing you men talk about this golden chain that stretches from eternity past to eternity future, and that God has a plan. And this God is not only planning, but has carried out and is carrying out that plan to save a people for his glory. And those people were given by name to the Son by the Father from eternity past. And that phrase that we looked at, whom he foreknew, he also predestined. And this chain, these links, are forged by God Almighty. And that's what the reference is here in verse 31. What then shall we say to these things? These things referring to this amazing work of God Almighty to save a people for the praise of his name, given to his son who was willing to come and die upon the cross. And that's the focus now of these two verses. If God be for us, who can be against us? It is a call for us to trust. It is a call for us to rest. It is a call for us to persevere. It is a call for us to have great joy and peace as we just give ourselves in the Lord Jesus Christ to this sovereign God and say, Lord, you take me and use me for your praise today. Lord, you have given me life in your son, and my life now is to live for you. And we see that, for example, over in Galatians 2:20, where the Apostle Paul said, I have been crucified with Christ, and it is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me, and the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself up for me. And so verse 31, if God be for us, who can be against us? Ultimately speaking, God Almighty, he reigns. And if he has planned to set his love upon us and is loving us, then everything's going to be okay. Everything's going to turn out great. And you hear people talk about that. And the context of this verse, back in verse 28, we know that God causes all things to work together for good. And there are a lot of people who hang on to this idea, well, everything's going to be okay. But that's not true for everybody.
Right.
It's only true for those who are trusting in the Lord Jesus Christ. It is only true for those who, by the grace of God, are clinging to the Lord Jesus Christ. And so that's the us. If God is for us, who's the us? Those that God planned and accomplished redemption and is applying redemption to in his son. If God be for us, who can be against us? And then
Yeah.
verse 32 is the evidence. God says, look, I have proven that you can trust me. I have proven that everything's going to be okay ultimately, because the greatest expression of God's love that could ever be, God has already given. And because God has not withheld his own son, but gave him up for us all. And again, the us there is God's sheep. The us there is those that are in this chain of God's saving grace and love and mercy, who are joined to the Lord Jesus Christ by a simple childlike faith. Those are the ones that God gives this incredible assurance to, that if God didn't spare his own son, all the other things that we need, God will freely give us. We can rest assured that if the greatest expression of God's love has already been given, all of these lesser expressions of his love surely will follow in Jesus.
Yeah. And our confession says in point eight of chapter three of God's decree, it says, so shall this doctrine of unconditional election, predestining grace, afford matter of praise, reverence, and admiration of God. And I wanted to come to Jim Thornton here. And so often when we talk about, I mean, the quickest way to clear out a room of evangelicals is to tell them, in 5 minutes, we're going to talk about predestination. Everybody heads for the hills. Nobody wants to talk about it. And yet, what do we see here in Romans 8:31, right after the golden chain of salvation and God speaking about those whom he foreknew and predestined, we see this outburst of worship and praise and just marveling at the grace of God. And I wanted to ask Jim, it says there, if God is for us, who can be against us? Is God for everybody?
No, he's not for everybody. He's for the elect. He's for those that he has chosen for the foundation of the world. And even though there's a bona fide offer of the gospel in a lesser sense, where Jesus looked out over Jerusalem and wept, and he said, how many times I would have gathered you like a hen under my wings, but you were not willing. They are
Right.
hostile towards God and at enmity with God, and they love sin and they hate God. And it's tragic. And it's as we move into Romans 9 here in a few minutes, Lord willing, we see how Paul is just brokenhearted over that, for his own people, the Jews of the descendants of Abraham in the flesh. He's just even willing to be cursed for them. He's so upset.
Yeah. So how about, let me read verse 33 and 34. Why don't you walk us through those, Jim? Who shall bring a charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is he who condemns? It is Christ who died, and furthermore is also risen, who is even at the right hand of God, who also makes intercession for us. So why don't you walk us through those two verses? Those are great passages.
Oh, no doubt. Who is the one who condemns? Well, Christ Jesus is he who died. Yes, rather, who was raised, who's at the right hand of God, who also intercedes for us. Like you say, he is our advocate, he is our defender, and he paid the price. And so nobody can come against us, not the devil, not any human being. Nobody can top that. The price has been paid, and continues intercession for us, applying the work of Christ, his own work. He applies it for us. So we are continually cleansed from our sins. As he said to Peter when he was washing the feet, you know, you're clean, but your feet need to be washed. And if you don't, then you have no part in me, showing the importance of the continued sanctification and the continued intercession of Christ. And then it says, who will separate us? Well, nobody will. Nobody can separate us from Christ. Not anything, not anybody, nobody, nothing. Yeah. Not affliction, turmoil, persecution, famine, nakedness, peril, or sword. Absolutely nothing. It is an inseparable bond. Praise the Lord. Martin Lloyd-Jones said, God is for me. I am his child because he is for me. And if God be for me, no one and nothing can be against me in the sense of ever separating me from him.
Yeah, it's just one of the most precious passages of God's word. And it's a shame that this section is separated very often in the way people memorize it from the preceding part about predestination and foreknowing and God's effectual call. But I wanted to speak just for a second to who will bring a charge against God's elect. You think one of the clearest themes of the Bible, one of the things that we try to get across to people is that God is the judge of the world. And he is the judge of every individual human being, past, present, and future, that has ever, will ever live, and all shall appear before him on that day of judgment. And that's a terrifying prospect when we consider how much sin we have committed in our lives. But what a glorious rhetorical question there. Who will bring a charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is he who condemns? So those two concepts, justification and condemnation, are set there as opposites. And why will we not be condemned? Why can no charge of sin be brought against me? It is Christ who died. Christ died for me. He was condemned in my place and in my stead. He has satisfied divine justice so that no charge of sin can be brought against me, because the one who stood in my place and died for me has borne that curse in my place and in my behalf. And that's the beating heart of the good news, isn't it?
Amen.
Yeah. Okay, Henry, let's look at verse 35 and 36. I'll read these. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are killed all day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. And you can include verse 37 if you'd like to, but would you comment on those verses, please?
Well, this idea of the things that we face in life, they are very real. One of the cults in our day and time denies the reality of evil. And how absurd, how stupid. Evil is very real, and the consequences of the fall still, we see all about us: sickness, death, brokenness, broken relationships. People get older, our bodies wear out, and death, turmoil, chaos, on and on we could go. And so these are precious, powerful verses. You can picture a parent sitting beside the bedside of a little child who is deathly sick in a hospital. Where are you going to find strength and comfort when that comes? Well, these verses are an incredible comfort to a person who is trusting in Jesus, because we know that God Almighty has promised that even though evil is real and the consequences of the fall are real, sickness, death, destruction, that if we belong to Jesus, we are in his hands. And he is going to take care of us. And he will bless us even in the midst. He has the power to heal and deliver if that pleases him. But sometimes it is his good pleasure not to get Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego out of the fire. He can, no matter how hot the fire is. He can come and rescue us. But sometimes he leaves us in the furnace for his glory. But even if that is what he is pleased to do, he will bless us. He will take care of us. And over in the book of Acts, you have the apostles. They were beaten. And when they were released, they rejoiced that they had been counted worthy to suffer for his name, to suffer shame for his name. You have Paul and Silas. They've been beaten. They're in Acts chapter 16. And what are they doing at midnight? They are resting in the hands of the sovereign God who has a plan for history. Now, they're in shackles. They've been beaten. They're hurting. They can't even sleep. So what are they doing? Singing praises to God. And this Philippian jailer, he's never seen anything like it in all his life. Men who've been horribly mistreated, but they still have hope and joy. Well, it's because they knew the God who has given his son and who reigns on high and is with them. And one of the themes in Scripture is about the name of Jesus, Emmanuel. And that's what these verses now are focusing on, that nothing can separate us from the love of God. Nothing can separate a true child of God from Jesus. He is with us, and he will never leave us nor forsake us. And so when a relationship is shattered, that's a horrible thing for people to go through. What will keep us from just despairing and giving up? Well, we look to this Jesus, to this God who has given his son. And God promises nothing in this life can separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Jesus reigns and has us in his hands. When we go through times, maybe you've lost your job. That can be a scary situation. What are you going to do now? Well, a Christian is somebody who looks to Jesus. And we say, Lord, I know you're going to take care of me. And as we hunt for another job, we do so looking to the Lord Jesus. And so that's the way we live life. These are very practical verses. And this teaching of God's sovereign grace, of his foreknowledge, his foreknowing us, setting his love upon us, and predestination are not cold, sterile, mean teachings of Scripture. But you see here now how God is applying them. These are the applications in everyday life to these amazing truths that this Jesus who set his love upon us, the Father gave a people to his Son, that now in time and in history, as we have been justified, called out of darkness into God's marvelous light, God's going to hang on to us. And that's our hope. That nail-scarred hands hold us and the future.
I've got a little story. When I was a chaplain in a nursing home, when I was in seminary, there was a man who was 100 years old. And I was always interested in what were the most important memories in these elderly people's lives. And he was telling me that his young son, probably about 10 years old, had been bitten by a spider and was dying. And he just lingered in bed for several days. And then he was continuing to decline. And then on his last day, he just looked up in the corner of the room and his face just lit up and he said, "I see, I see." And Tom Stevens, the man who was 100 years old, he said, you know, and it reminded me of Stephen looking up into heaven as he was being martyred and seeing the Lord Jesus. And so here was the comfort. And 70 years later, I estimate, here was Tom Stevens still being comforted by the fact that nothing can separate us from the love of God, not death. Henry spoke of being beside a hospital bed, and it reminded me of this story. And 70 years later, this man is still comforted by this truth that's right here in this passage.
Yeah. So even as Christians, even for the people that God loves with an infinite, eternal love from before the foundation of the world, it's his plan that tribulation and distress, persecution, famine, nakedness, peril, sword will often happen to us. Okay, so let's look at verse 37, 38, and 39, great block of text. And I'll read this passage and just I'll ask you both to comment on it. I'll have Jim comment first. "Yet in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord." So, Jim, what do you think? just comment on that great passage.
The it says in 1 John, you know, we're conquerors. We're more than conquerors. And, you know, if you win some kind of Olympic prize or something like that, it's thrilling for a little while, but then you're still facing death and decline in this world. But here, overwhelmingly conquer, and it's through him. It's not us. We can't accomplish this. We don't even have one single milligram of goodness in us, our perseverance without him. He's keeping us, and it's just amazing that we don't just conquer, we overwhelmingly conquer through him who loved us. And, you know, I was watching a debate yesterday and with some students, and it was Richard Dawkins, the most famous atheist in the world, and one of his former atheists, who was raised as a Muslim, who has now become a Christian. And Dawkins was saying, but Christianity is all about sin. And she said, "No, I see Christianity as being more about love." And right here, it talks about his love. We're overwhelmingly conquer through him who loved us. And yeah, sin's an issue, but his love, he's loved us with an everlasting love. And because of his love, he went to the cross for the joy set before him to redeem his people. He went to the cross to save us out of his love. His love held him to the cross.
Yeah. And it's so important that we see the cross manifests both aspects of God's nature, his love and his justice. And, you know, there are people in the 19th century trying to say, well, the cross is just this giant act of love and there's nothing else to it. And B.B. Warfield responded to that and said, that would be like me killing one of my own kids just to show you how much I love you. Which would make no sense at all. The point is, it's because it satisfies divine justice and reconciles us to God that we can call it a loving act. And so it's love and justice married together in his being nailed to the cross. But Henry, what are your thoughts about those final three verses, verse 37, 38, and 39 of Romans 8 there?
Well, in the Old Testament, there is a passage in Zechariah chapter 3 that I think gives to us a wonderful reminder of what the love of God is all about. In Zechariah chapter 3, the Lord showed Zechariah this vision of a event that was taking place in the throne room of heaven. And in verse 1, he says, "Then he showed me Joshua, the high priest." Now, in the Old Testament economy, you had these shadows of Christ, and you had the temple, you had the sacrifices, and a priest would take a blood sacrifice and go into the presence of God there in the temple. And here is Joshua now, the one who is supposed to be going on behalf of the people to ask for forgiveness. And so that's the scene. Standing before the angel of the Lord and Satan standing at his right hand to oppose him. And so earlier in this passage, the Apostle Paul in Romans 8 asks, who is there to condemn? Well, there's all kinds of people who would step forward to condemn us. Satan points his finger and saying, look, Henry's done wrong. He has no right. Well, what's the answer to that? There are other people that would oppose. Well, in verse 2, the Lord said to Satan, the Lord rebuke you, Satan. The Lord who has chosen Jerusalem rebuke you. Is this not a brand plucked from the fire? Now Joshua was clothed with filthy garments and was standing before the angel. And so here's this picture, this priest who's supposed to be coming into the presence of God to represent the people of God. He's got filthy garments on. He doesn't have the right to stand there. And so what hope is there for Joshua? What hope is there for God's people? And it is the angel of the Lord, the messenger of the Lord Jesus Christ, who steps forward. And he rebukes Satan and steps in. And notice what he says. The Lord rebuke you, Satan. The Lord who has chosen Jerusalem rebuke you. And then speaks specifically about Joshua himself and says, is this not a brand plucked from the fire? And that is a description of what I deserve. I don't deserve to even be alive because I am fallen in Adam and I have sinned. I've broken every one of God's holy commandments. And so why does God not condemn me and cast me into hell? And there's only one reason. It is the mercy of God. And he has given me and you, dear brothers, life in his son. Jesus has stepped forward and he has pled his own perfect life and his own perfect sacrifice as the payment for sin and as our righteousness, our covering. And so this is a wonderful picture, a thrilling picture of what happens to a person left to ourselves. We're covered with filth, with the filth of sin, the guilt of sin. And Jesus is the only one who can intercede for us. He's the only one who can deliver us. And so who is there to condemn? Well, the only one ultimately who is the judge of all the earth is God Almighty. And God has given his own son to be our advocate, as Brother Jim, you mentioned earlier. As we see in this passage of Zechariah 3, and in verse 4, he says, then he answered and spoke to those who stood before him, saying, take away the filthy garments from him. And to him he said, see, I have removed your iniquity from you, and I will clothe you with rich robes. That's the Lord Jesus. And the second we put our trust in Jesus, Jesus, his perfect sacrifice on the cross pays for our sin. That legal declaration of the judge of all the earth declaring us not guilty. And then he clothes us also with his righteousness, and he declares us at the same time not only not guilty, but righteous. And so that's what Romans 8 now is closing with. It is this reminder that there is nothing in the spiritual realm, no kings, no political parties, no movements. Karl Marx can't, the followers of communism can't, liberal so-called churches can't. Nothing can separate the child of God who is trusting in Jesus from the love of God. We are kept in his mighty sovereign hands. And he calls yes. us to trust in him and follow him.
Yes. All right, very good. So there we have the end of Romans 8. So let's go now to move into Romans 9. Let's see, we're about a half hour and we're good. So Jim, why don't you read the first five verses or so there? I think I'll just kind of preface this a little bit with, so here you have Paul. He kind of spells out the whole, you know, gospel message. He starts there in Romans 1, 18 about the judgment of God against Gentiles. Romans 2, the judgment of God is also against the Jewish people. They sinned in all the same ways the Gentiles did. But then you have the gospel kind of being spelled out there in Romans 3, 4, 5. Then you have the Christian life in Romans 6 and 7. And then Romans 8, there's no condemnation. No matter how much we struggle with sin, no matter how much we fall, we are in Christ. There's no condemnation because of God's predestining plan and everything else. But then I think the question comes up, Jim, you know, that Paul was probably faced with. If the gospel goes first to the Jew and why to the Gentile, why are so few Jews believing, at least at the time that Paul was preaching? There weren't very many. There were some, but there weren't very many. And that's when he moves into Romans 9, 10, 11, his discussion of the sovereignty of God. So why don't you read the opening five verses there and just comment on those for us?
9:1, I am telling the truth in Christ. I am not lying. My conscience testifies with me in the Holy Spirit that I have great sorrow and unceasing grief in my heart. For I could wish that I myself were accursed, separated from Christ for the sake of my brothers, my kinsmen, according to the flesh, who are the Israelites, to whom belong the adoption as sons and the glory and the covenants and the giving of the law and the temple service and the promises, whose are the fathers, and from whom is the Christ, according to the flesh, who is God over all, blessed forever. Amen. Well, first of all, Paul starts out emphasizing that this isn't just what he's saying. He's in union with Christ and the Holy Spirit, his conscience testifying. So what you have here in verse 1 is from not just Paul himself, but Christ and the Holy Spirit. And then he talks about in verse 2, his great sorrow and unceasing grief in his heart. Verse 3, so much so that he could wish that I myself were accursed, separated from Christ for the sake of my brothers, my kinsmen, according to the flesh. I mean, this is beyond bounds right here. His love for these people is just unbounded. He's even willing to be accursed. And then he names who they are in verse 4, the Israelites. And then he talks about all these benefits, adoption as sons, the glory, the covenants, the Adamic covenant, the Noahic covenant, the Mosaic covenant. All these covenants belong to them and were given to them. And then the giving of the law, well, the Mosaic covenant again, the temple service, which showed that there was a way to continue in fellowship with God in spite of sin, that God was forgiving. And all this, of course, pointing to Christ. And it says, and the promises. And I believe it's specifically talking about the promises of the Messiah. Psalm 22, Isaiah 53, and on and on. I mean, there's tons of promises. And he says, whom are the fathers, from whom is the Christ? And he gets right to Christ according to the flesh. Now, notice he proclaims the deity of Jesus Christ right here. Christ, from whom is the Christ according to the flesh, who is God over all. blessed forever. Amen. You know, some liberals say that Paul never declares the deity of Christ. Well, right here, he's doing it.
Amen.
Yeah, exactly. I've always thought Paul, I think one of the reasons Paul had such a passion for Israel, as you were just kind of pointing out there, is especially hard-hearted, stubborn, cantankerous Jewish opposition, is he had been one himself. You know, and one of my favorite narratives in the book of Acts about Paul is, just every time I come across this, it blows my mind, is in Acts 14:19, where it says, then Jews from Antioch and Iconium came there, and having persuaded the multitudes, they stoned Paul and dragged him out of the city, supposing him to be dead. However, when the disciples gathered around him, he rose up and went into the city. It's like, I mean, they stoned him, and they must have knocked him unconscious.
Yeah,
because they thought he was dead. They just left him there. He gets up and brushes himself off and goes right back. And he's ready to go back and start preaching some more. I think that he saw himself in those people, and I think that's why he was so determined. It's inspiring to think about, isn't it? The love he had for those people. But
and imagine their shock when, after they had beaten him, knocked him unconscious, drug him out of town, and he walks back in. What were they to conclude except, wow, this guy, he's serious. He loves us. I hope that was their response.
Yeah, you would think so. I think people had to be moved and inspired by his courage and his determination. It's incredible. But yeah, that's a good introduction to Paul's going to move into now his discussion of God's sovereign determination. This is really where we get the Westminster Confession gets a lot of his teaching. Obviously, it's all the way through the Bible, but the discriminatory decree of election and God's sovereignty in choosing among the mass of equally undeserving humanity who he is going to show mercy to. So, Brother Henry, why don't you plow into verses 6-9 and comment on those for us, please?
Okay, sure. But it is not that the word of God has taken no effect, for they are not all Israel who are of Israel, nor are they all children because they are the seed of Abraham, but in Isaac your seed shall be called. That is, those who are the children of the flesh, these are not the children of God, but the children of the promise are counted as the seed. For this is the word of promise, at this time I will come, and Sarah shall have a son. And so here we see now the question being posed again in verse 6. If the gospel is so great, and that's what the theme of Romans chapters 1-8, if the gospel is so great, well, then what do we do with so many Jews who do not believe? And that's what the Apostle Paul now, by the Holy Spirit, begins to address in the heart of the matter. And he says, but it is not that the word of God has taken no effect. He says, we've got to understand that this is the way it has always been. It's not just physical descent that is the key. And he points to how it is the sovereign work of God. It is grace. It is God discriminating, God taking these physical descendants, Isaac, Ishmael, they both descended from Abraham. Ishmael was a mocker, and that's why he was cast out. Ishmael had the privilege of hearing the promises, but he rejected those and mocked. And that's why he was cast out. Well, behind the scenes, God was at work. And why did Isaac experience the grace of God? Well, it was because that's what God chose to do. Mm-hmm. And in Deuteronomy chapter 7, you know, a lot of people come to this chapter and they say, well, now this is just talking about nations. It's not talking about individuals. Well, God does deal with nations. And who are nations? Groups of individuals. Yeah. And so what a silly argument to say that this doesn't have anything to do with individuals because God deals with nations. Well, Ishmael was an individual. Isaac was an individual. And yes, there were people that descended from them. But God is sovereign over it all. And to pit God's either dealing with individuals or he's dealing with nations against each other, it is no argument against what Scripture is teaching us. And so here we see that it is those who are children of the promise who are counted as God's seed, as those who are the heirs of the promises of God. And what determined which group they were in? Well, ultimately, it's God. God is the one who chose to set his love upon an Isaac. That's why Isaac believed. And why did Ishmael mock? It was because God left him in his state of unbelief. And God was not unjust. God didn't make Ishmael sin, but this promise of God now, the only hope for a fallen, lost sinner, which is what I am apart from the grace of God. My only hope, your only hope, is the grace of God. That God is saving his people in Jesus. And that's what these verses are highlighting now, that it was God who made Isaac a child of promise.
Right. And so when you think about the flow of the argument here, like you said, it doesn't make any sense to apply this to nations, because that really is an argument against the way Paul himself is interpreting his own words. And so you have Paul spelling out there in the opening five verses that Jim walked through there. Yeah, the Jewish people have these great privileges and promises, but then he moves into Israel's history. Why was the covenant established with Isaac, not Ishmael? God is sovereign. And I'll read the next little block and just make some comments, and I'll ask Jim to chime in on verses 10 through 13. Then he moves to another example, verse 10. And not only this, but when Rebekah also had conceived by one man, even by our father Isaac, for the children not yet being born, nor having done any good or evil, that the purpose of God according to election might stand, not of works, but of him who calls, it was said to her, the older shall serve the younger, as it is written, Jacob I have loved, but Esau I have hated. I've heard Reformed theologians say Romans 9:11 is the clearest statement of unconditional election in the entire Bible. I mean, look at what it says. There's four different ways it's said there. The children not yet being born, nor having done any good or evil, that the purpose of God according to election might stand. And then he throws in, not of works, but of him who calls. It's like saying that they've not yet been born and haven't done anything good or evil yet. That's not enough. He just throws another phrase in there, not of works, but of him who calls. It's almost like Paul's trying to anticipate someone's going to try to attribute something to these unborn children to differentiate them, but he simply points out his application there, not of works, but of him who calls. It was said to her, the older shall serve the younger, as it is written, Jacob I have loved, but Esau I have hated. And people will say, well, the citation from Malachi is about nations, but Paul is clearly applying it to individuals, not nations. And so that's Paul's own understanding of his own words there. But Jim, do you have any comments on that block of text?
Well, I'm just reminded of, I asked some students the other day, I said, do you want God to be fair with you? And they said, yes. And I said, well, then you'll go to hell. And it's not that God's unfair, but you got to put the fairness, as Patrick said earlier, with the love, with the cross. It's both. Justice and mercy meet at the cross. And so if you just get fairness, then you perish. But now I'm looking at the Legacy Standard Bible, and it says in verse 11, for though the twins were not yet born and had not done anything good or bad, they had not, you know, I had a Arminian telling me the other day that Calvinism was heresy. And I said, well, you know, you're saying that they made a choice. They decided to choose God. No, the scripture says they hadn't done anything good or bad. They hadn't done anything at all. And so it's completely God's mercy and compassion. Yeah.
So think about this. That's a good, really good points there. When we share this truth with people that God is the one at the end of the day is ultimately sovereign. Yes, we preach the gospel to everyone. We don't live by the decreed will of God because it's not revealed to us. We don't know who the elect are. So we try to evangelize everybody and we call people to faith in Christ. But at the end of the day, God is the one who is sovereign over this matter. God is the one who has mercy on whom he wills and hardens whom he wills. What is the response that people give to that? What do they say? That's not what?
It's not fair.
That's not fair. That's unrighteous. So, Henry, why don't you read verse 14 and 15 and comment on those?
Absolutely. What shall we say then? Is there unrighteousness with God? Certainly not. For he says to Moses, I will have mercy on whomever I will have mercy, and I will have compassion on whomever I will have compassion. The Lord has declared to us in his word how and why people believe. And this really does put the blowtorch to human pride. Because what these verses are saying is God would have been just. He would have been fair, as Brother Jim made reference, to leave all mankind in the state of sin and headed to the very pits of hell and experience that. God would be just to give me what I deserve. But the message of the gospel is that God, the holy, holy, holy God, planned before the foundation of the world to give a people to his son to come and redeem. And when Jesus died on the cross, he purchased redemption for his sheep. He didn't just die to make it possible, but he died and secured eternal redemption for his lost sheep. Now it has to be applied. And that's the work of God, the Holy Spirit. But here in Romans 9, he's answering the question in verse 14, well, that doesn't sound fair to me. And he says, is their unrighteousness with God? Is God fair? Is he unrighteous in the way he's dealing with people to leave an Esau in his sin?
Yeah.
And to set his love upon a Jacob? And you know, Esau, he despised God. He despised the gospel promises. He was willing to sell all of the promises of God for a bowl of red stew. He said, that's all the promises of the Christ are worth to me. As a matter of fact, the promises of Christ, I would rather have this bowl of red stew. And so was God unjust to give Esau what he wanted and what he deserved? No, God wasn't unjust. Jacob, here's this man who lied to his old blind daddy and tricked him. Why would God love a Jacob? It's amazing. God rescued Jacob out of what he deserved. And as we go on into Romans chapter 9, we're going to see from the same lump of clay, God chose to make some vessels for wrath and some vessels for mercy. And here, yeah, earlier in this chapter now, he asked the question, is there unrighteousness with God? And the answer is, he answers it, certainly not.
By
no means. God would be just to leave all mankind into the state of sin. But the wonder of the gospel is God chose to give a huge number of people. The book of Revelation tells us it is a number that we can't number. God knows the number, and God gave those people by name to his son. And that's the wonder of the gospel. And so God declares, I will have mercy on whomever I will have mercy, and I will have compassion on whomever I will have compassion. That's the wonder of the gospel. And we offer the gospel to all men everywhere, and God takes that gospel and speaks it to the hearts of his lost sheep and draws his sheep unto his son.
Yeah. And that citation there is from Exodus 33:19, when Moses is getting the second copy of the Ten Commandments, and he says, "Show me your glory." And God says, "No, you can't look at my face and live." And he says, "I'll cause my goodness to pass by. You may see my backside." And he gives him that assertion, "I'll have mercy on whom I have mercy. I'll have compassion on whom I have compassion." Now, I want to get Jim to read and comment on verses 16, 17, and 18. But before you read those, Jim, I want to read from Exodus 9 where the citation is taken from in verse 17 there, when Moses appears in front of Pharaoh. Just listen to this passage, Exodus 9:13. "Then the Lord said to Moses, rise early in the morning and stand before Pharaoh and say to him, thus says Yahweh, God of the Hebrews, let my people go that they may serve me. For at this time, I will send all my plagues to your very heart and on your servants and on your people, that you may know that there is none like me in all the earth. Now, if I had stretched out my hand and struck you and your people with pestilence, then you would have been cut off from the earth." And then he gives the citation that Paul is going to use here in verse 17. "But indeed, for this purpose, I have raised you up, that I may show my power in you, and that my name may be declared in all the earth." And so you have Moses, this old man, standing in front of one of the most pompous, arrogant rulers of this world, who likens himself to a god. And God, through Moses, is telling him, "You exist. I brought you up for this one reason, to display my power, and that my name may be declared in all the earth." You think of the Pharaohs put their names on everything, all their monuments and tombs and everything else, and yet you have this incredible statement. So you see the application Paul makes to individuals, not nations. And so, Brother Jim, would you read verses 16, 17, and 18 and comment on those for us, please?
Starting with verse 16, "So then it does not depend on the one who wills or the one who runs, but on God who has mercy. For the scripture says to Pharaoh, for this very purpose I raised you up, in order to demonstrate my power in you, and in order that my name might be proclaimed throughout the whole earth. So then he has mercy on whom he desires, and he hardens whom he desires." I want to share a quote from Augustine, written in On Grace and Free Will. He says, "The man whom God permits to go astray and to become hardened has deserved this evil, while the man upon whom he had mercy has received the grace of God, who has rendered good for evil." So God renders good for evil for us, showing us his grace and mercy. But Pharaoh, he deserved what he got. And of course, we all deserve hell, as Henry has said, every one of us, but God is no respecter of persons. And so let me back up here It doesn't depend on the one who wills or the one who runs. It's not anything that man does. It's God who has mercy. You know, God had a purpose for letting Pharaoh go, which I see as the equivalent of hardening his heart, just giving him over to what he wanted to do. You know, God didn't violate his will in that. He just let him do what he wanted to do. And that is the equivalent of the hardening of the heart. But God used it for a purpose. I raised you up in order to demonstrate my power in you. You know, if it weren't for these vessels of wrath, what would we know about the wrath of God? And throughout eternity, you know, we're going to see the smoke going up and be reminded of God's justice and the wrath that we all deserved, but which we didn't get because of his grace and mercy. And so he says, you know, I raised Pharaoh up for this, that his name would be proclaimed throughout the whole earth. And of course, Jesus said, go into the whole world and proclaim the gospel. This is part of the message. So bottom line is there in verse 18. So then he has mercy on whom he desires, and he hardens whom he desires.
Isn't that glorious? I mean, that is so encouraging. I am so thankful that God did not leave me in my sins, because he could have done that and it wouldn't have violated a single canon of justice or righteousness. And the only reason we're believers is because of that mercy. But Brother Henry, you were going to say something there, brother. What would you like to add to that?
Well, I was just going to mention, when you read the account there in Exodus of Pharaoh, there are, in some of the plagues, it says that Pharaoh hardened his heart. And then at other times, it says God hardened Pharaoh's heart. So what's going on there? Well, Romans chapter 1 talks about this judgment of God that he righteously gives. And in Romans chapter 1, there is a description of what hardening looks like. And I think it's really important, Patrick, you mentioned, and Brother Jim, you also made reference to it, you brothers both, that God doesn't violate our wills.
Yep.
Here we have in Romans chapter 1 that because they suppress the truth in unrighteousness, what do we see the language of Scripture? What did God do to that? Well, God turned them over to what they wanted. God did not make anybody sin. He gave them over. That's the language of Scripture. In verse 24 of Romans 1, therefore God also gave them up to uncleanness. And you see the same thing down in verse 26. For this reason, God gave them up to vile passions. And down in verse 28, and even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a debased mind. And so here we see the justice of God, and that's what God did with Pharaoh. That's the hardening. God, as a judge, said, okay, you don't want my gospel. You don't want the offer of mercy. I'll give you what you want. I'll turn you over. God gave them up. And that is the justice of God. And the mercy of God is that he gives to us grace, a heart that repents and believes in Jesus. And so who gets the glory? And you, dear brothers, mentioned this last broadcast that in the Lord's providence, able to join with you all, but I listened to it. I've listened to it twice, actually. It was such a thrill the first time. I said, I got to listen to this again. But God Almighty is offering mercy, and he is calling all men everywhere to repent. And we know that God has a people he is going to save. We don't know who God's sheep are. But we do know that God has given us the privilege of offering the gospel, calling everybody to repent and believe in Jesus. And God is at work in this fallen world, dealing with mankind, individuals, as he sees fit, saving his sheep and giving over those who are vessels of justice to their own sin.
Yeah.
Repent and believe in Jesus.
Yes. And so all three of us would confess together that we would never have had a desire to repent or believe in Jesus had God not foreknown, predestined, effectually called, and then justified us. Amen. Right?
Amen.
Now, I want to read Charles Spurgeon's Arminian Prayer, and then we'll get Jim Thornton to comment on them. We'll close. But here's Charles Spurgeon's Arminian. An Arminian on his knees would pray like this, quote, if he was consistent, quote, Lord, I thank thee. I am not like those poor, presumptuous Calvinists, Lord. I was born with a glorious free will. I was born with power by which I can turn to thee of myself. I have improved my grace. If everybody had done the same with their grace that I have, they might all have been saved. Lord, I know that thou dost not make us willing if we are not willing ourselves. Thou givest grace to everybody. Some do not improve it, but I did. There are many that will go to hell as much bought with the blood of Christ as I was. They had as much of the Holy Ghost given to them. They had as good a chance and were as much blessed as I am. It was not thy grace that made us to differ. I know it did a great deal. Still, I turned the point. I made use of what was given to me, and others did not. That is the difference between me and them. Amen. What do you think about that, Jim?
Well, that's definitely boasting, and the scripture over and over again says there's no room for boasting. God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. And I want to read a quote from John Calvin. He says, the flesh rages when it hears the predestination to death of those who perish in God's will. So they're raging. People put the blame on God and accuse him of tyranny. And if God would, as if God would forget his own righteousness and throw everything into confusion. And that Arminian prayer is definitely a sign of confusion.
Yeah.
And praise God, Charles Spurgeon did not believe that.
Amen.
Yeah. That's the Arminian.
He was just saying, here's what a prayer, if it were consistent from an Arminian point of view. And the bottom line is God is the one that we praise, because had he not planned, purchased, and now sovereignly applied, taking out my heart of stone and giving me a heart of repentance and faith in Jesus, I would be lost. I wouldn't be trusting in Christ. None of us would. And we just glory in the God of grace. All praise goes to him.
Amen. And it's such a glorious and encouraging thing to worship God as the sovereign one, as the sovereign king of the universe that holds all things in his hands. And so I read that Arminian thing from Spurgeon. I'll read one more Spurgeon quote. He says, men will allow God to be everywhere but on his throne. They will allow him to be in his workshop to fashion worlds and make stars. They will allow him to be in his almonry to dispense his alms and bestow his bounties. They will allow him to sustain the earth and bear up the pillars thereof, or light the lamps of heaven, or rule the waves of the ever-moving ocean. But when God ascends his throne, his creatures then begin to gnash their teeth. And we proclaim an enthroned God and his right to do as he wills with his own, to dispose of his creatures as he thinks well, without consulting them in the matter. Then it is that we are hissed and execrated, but then it is that men turn a deaf ear to us, for God on his throne is not the God they love, but it is God upon the throne that we love to preach. It is God upon his throne whom we trust.
Amen.
Go ahead, Jim.
I was, Satan threw a fiery dart at me yesterday of temptation. And I was resisting it. I was praying, Lord, help me. And the comforting thought is, I wouldn't even do that were it not for the grace of God. And that shows God's presence in my life right there. So it turns out that Satan is trying to attack me, but the Lord is comforting me.
Yes.
Yeah, that's glorious. Yeah, the war, the irreconcilable war is indicative that we are in Christ. Because the non-Christian doesn't have that battle. He doesn't ask for help when he's tempted. He gives into it and loses.
Amen.
Okay, well, brothers, I thank you so much for your time. Let me close us in a brief prayer. Father, indeed, you are enthroned over all, and we bless and praise your holy name for your sovereign determination to choose freely to have mercy on equally undeserving people and to bypass others for the manifestation of your glorious justice. And we pray that you would help us to see we are believers in Jesus Christ. If we are true believers, it is not because we're better. It's not because we're smarter. It's not because we made use of what you gave us and others did not, but solely because of your sovereign choice. It is not of him who wills, nor of him who runs, but of God who shows mercy. Therefore, he has mercy on whom he wills, and whom he wills, he hardens. May our hearts rejoice in the glorious manifestation of grace that we see in the salvation of your precious blood-bought people. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you, guys. You guys have a good Lord's Day. I'm going to Chicago. Pray for me. I'm speaking at a church up in Chicago on biblical manhood and womanhood. So I've got guys filling the pulpit here, but I'm praying for safe travels. So
amen.
And we'll be praying. Take care.
You
we'll see you next time.
We'll be with
all right. Bye-bye.
God bless.